I grew up with his kids.
Wait, Norman Braman was from...
Norman Braman's from Miami Beach. Oh, he was
kidding.
From Philly originally.
Yeah.
He made his empire in Miami.
Right.
Selling Cadillacs.
And then went back. When did he own... He owned the Eagles from when to when?
From too long ago to remember to too long.
Yeah.
To forget.
And they never won a championship.
Yeah. But he was, you know, a good guy. It was good to see him at the, you know, High Holidays. Figure out how many rows behind Norman Draymond you were. Figure out how powerful you were.
That's amazing.
That's amazing. You guys met before, right?
I think so. We saw each other on set once or twice.
Yeah,
once
passing.
Or twice.
Yeah.
That's hilarious.
Yeah.
So, why?
This?
Yeah. What got you going?
Katherine Graham. I read her memoir maybe 6 or 7 years ago, and I just fell in love with her. I mean, it's the best memoir I've ever read, not because it's impeccably researched, which she did, and vetted and sourced, but because she has such an honest perspective of her life. Mm-hmm. She has a vulnerability about talking about herself and the mistakes she made and the relationships she had, and that was to me just so inspiring and something I felt I related to so much that I was like, this is the story of a woman that I want out there. But I didn't know what the movie was because she had like 10 different lives. You know, there could have been 10 different movies, a couple miniseries, probably a TV show. And
where were you in your life at that point? Because I mean, when you say, like, I don't know where the movie is, like you've made 23 movies and you're going to
make
one more movie.
Right, no, at the point that I started to write it, I was writing full-time, but I had sold a pilot, and I was sort of sitting at my kitchen table trying to figure it out. And I had just finished working on this web series, and my husband was like, I had been talking about writing this movie forever, and my husband was like, just do it. You know, there's 3 months. Just take it and write it and see what happens. And they're like, if it's not good, it's not good. But if it is, then you'll have written it.
Was writing always the track you were on?
No, I worked in development for a while. I went to graduate school at AFI for producing. I thought I was going to be a creative producer. And I worked in development for about 4.5 years, 5 years, and sort of 2 years into it, I was like, oh, I want to be on the other side. I love working with producers. I love working with directors, and I love the collaboration process of it. And that was, I also wanted to be the one that was doing the notes, not giving them.
Right.
And so I left to write full-time about 5 years ago, and it was terrifying, you know, quitting your job was the thing that I'm happy I was young enough to not be as terrified as I would be now.
Yeah.
But it was, yeah, I mean, I sort of kind of threw caution to the wind. I was like, let's see what happens.
So this was just, okay, I'll take the flyer on the 3 months and see.
Yeah, I have my managers and my lawyer who I've been working with for many years, and I didn't have an agent. And so the writing of this script was literally like, maybe I'll get an agent. You know, I'll write this story if it's good. It'll have a voice and it'll have my voice, and that'll be great. And then it sort of took off like wildfire. I did end up getting an agent, which was a nice cherry on top.
So it sounds like Amy Pascal was the wildfire.
She was. She is still. She is still the wildfire, by the way.
That is a good way to. She is a wildfire.
That.
That's right. That's amazing.
Yeah,
that's amazing.
She bought the script about the weekend of Halloween last year, and called.
Were you
me.
Expecting? Were you like? I'm obviously was out, but did you expect?
So
it to
was
be that
sort
quick?
Of out, but it wasn't. So it had gone to agencies because I was working with this company, our executive producers on the film, Star Thrower, Tim and Trevor White. And they were amazing. And so they're like, let's send it to agents. And so whoever signs you, we can package it and make the movie. And we were like, we're going to make this tiny little movie. And then, you know, maybe somebody will see. And we had it. It was, I think, like a couple weeks, maybe 10 days it had been out to the agents. And then it got slipped to a studio head or a studio executive sort of on like Thursday night. And Friday morning, my manager called me and was like, don't answer the phone. And I was like, why? Am I like getting arrested? Why? What's happening? And she was like, no, it's just people are really interested in there's, we're getting offers for the script, but like nobody can, you shouldn't talk to anybody. And I was like, okay. So my husband at the time was, not at the time, my husband but at the time, was same husband.
Don't worry about it.
Yeah. Was, I know. I've only been around for a while.
Poor Brian.
Yeah,
wow.
Yeah.
He's, man, thrown onto the bus. And he's the one who told you to sit down.
I know.
Oh, my God. It's terrible.
He read the first 165-page draft. I mean, he's a saint. He's also the reason we don't have that kitchen table anymore, though.
It's gone?
Yeah, I told you. He broke his foot on it.
Oh, right. But you know, so the kitchen table gives and it takes away.
It gives. It took.
Again,
it
gives to you and it takes from Brian.
It did.
Poor Brian.
I know. He really did suffer.
He broke his foot at the kitchen table and made you get rid of the table?
I made myself get rid of the kitchen table. It was a solid block of wood that he slammed his foot into, and it was like a very not pretty sight. And so
we had a table in the kitchen that my son ran into when he was 5 and cut his forehead.
It was,
and that moved.
Yeah, it was very quick. Like, it was also one of those tables that like we had stubbed our toes on for like years, and it was like one day it'll happen, and then
a
it happened.
A metaphor for being a screenwriter.
It was, and then it broke my foot. It broke his foot and it's gone. But anyways, my current, constant, only husband, a year and a half ago. Was he's also a writer, and he was in New York on location at the time. So when I get this phone call from a manager that's like, "Stay in your house, don't talk to anybody," I was like, "I literally don't have anyone to talk to. I'm alone. My husband is 3 hours ahead. He's doing night shoots." So I was sort of just like pacing in my house for 7 hours, and then at 11:30 that night or midnight, I get a call that at 11:30 I get a call that says Amy Pascal's going to buy the script, and I was like, "What? What are you talking about?" Like, it's like, and like, yeah, she bought it. She wants to talk to you. And I was like, when? They're like, now. I was like, I'm in bed. Okay, that sounds great.
Wildfire.
Yeah, wildfire. Hashtag wildfire.
You best pal in bed with you. We'll start a rumor.
But she called me, and, you know, it was the first of many, many conversations we've both had with Amy about kind of her just love of Katherine Graham, her love of this world, and her passion for making this movie. And it was by far, I think that, and then the phone call that Steve and Tom and Meryl are reading it, those are the two most bizarre phone calls I've ever received.
So how long was the window between that first call in bed to actually having Steven and Tom and Meryl?
I think it was about 3 months, maybe. They read it, they all read it the same weekend in February, I believe.
So pretty much normal.
Yeah, it was like totally casual.
Yeah.
Yeah. Not a big deal.
The way it always works.
This is how it works.
I have to jump in here and just say that, in all seriousness, Amy and Christine Kosko-Krieger, who are the two producers, you know, with Steven on this movie, they are remarkable. And I think for, you know, I mean, this story to me is a story of an incredible script, right? Best spec script I've ever read. Right, and then Amy
I've been
cutting
him checks.
And then
currently hasn't read his own scripts. So he's running himself. But
just like, you know, like Amy picking up that ball, getting it to which you know is just you know the persistence of Amy Pascal. You know, the story is about 9 phone calls in one day.
It's true.
I mean, that's how you get Steven, Tom, and Meryl to all read in a weekend.
And
right?
Then make the movie 10 weeks
and
later.
And then Christy picking up the ball with her and actually getting this done.
Yeah.
Right? In that kind of speed. I mean, I don't know any other producer in Hollywood who could literally have that kind of turnaround on a new piece of material and to turn out something, you know, and obviously you've got, you know, a director who's been around the barn a couple times and who happens to be, oh, maybe the greatest living director who's going to then take it home. But literally the work of Amy and Christy, to me, is remarkable.
I think that, yeah, and it's sort of the unsung story of, like, you know, what we were lucky to witness on set is these two women who are just kicking ass at all times and not kind of letting anyone know, like, if they're stressed out or what problem they're, what fight. You know, what fire they're putting out. It was just like, we were just making a movie and they were making all of it happen.
Yeah. I mean, you know, often you have the producers who like package a movie and then disappear. And then you have the producers who really are just more of the nitty gritty on set. And they just everything, like anything,
any
issue.
They were also doing, Christy and Steven were also doing another movie.
Right. I mean, that's
while
the other
doing
thing.
This.
Right. They're like, he's posting Ready Player One out at the same time. And by the way, posting this movie too.
Yeah.
It's one of the reasons why it can happen so quickly is Steven literally posts. I mean, he literally, it's amazing because, you know, I've been on set with Damien Chazelle on First Man, which is, you know, I'm very excited about. Damien's terrific. And I literally have been trying to figure out, I don't understand
how Steven makes that time. Because, you know, like, there's no time, and yet Steven manages to, every scene is cut five times before he gets to the end of the movie. Because he literally, you know, while Janusz is lighting, he disappears, right? Yeah. And goes and cuts. Yeah. It's the craziest
or
thing in the
proves,
world.
Or proves, you know, ILM stuff. Or, like, I mean, for me, it's also the compartmentalization of it, where I'm like, I'm still thinking about the scene that we're shooting in, like, 7 hours, and you have not only moved past that scene and tomorrow, but you're on to the movie that's coming out in 6 months. And, like his ability to just completely shift his brain to focus completely on what he is looking at one time is stunning.
Yeah.
But he has a pretty good crew with him.
Yeah, I mean, that's the other thing. I mean, Rick Carter, Ann Roth, I mean, the people around are just... But going back, again, so none of this happens without the greatest spec script ever written, right? Never, none of this happens without... So the genius of Liz, to me, is... So you've got this story about, you know, about the First Amendment, about, you know, freedom of the press, about, you know, these weighty issues, and you decide to tell it through this very personal lens of Kay Graham, through, you know, through this story of a woman, you know, having to find her voice, right? You know, a woman who is never supposed to be CEO of a company, you know, who takes over a Fortune 500 company and winds up... Who's passed over, you know, her father gives the company to her husband, and, you know, because that's what they did at the time, right? And who winds up being... At the time, what did I say?
No, I'm agreeing with you. I'm saying we're so far past that.
Right, exactly. When only 5% of, you know, CEOs of Fortune 500 companies are women, right?
Yeah.
This is sadly not something in the past, but, you know, but nonetheless, she becomes, you know, one of the greatest CEOs ever. I mean, she could, you know, Warren Buffett will go on and on about how she quadrupled the stock price, like, so, you know, this is an incredible story of a woman finding her voice. It's incredible. You know, as we were talking earlier, you know, non-rom-com of this...
An unromantic love story.
You know, of this, you know, I mean, Kay had hired Ben. One of her first hires was Ben Bradley, right? And, you know, he'd been running the paper for 5 years. You know, they had a marriage, which was a good marriage, but, you know, was not, you know, was then severely tested here, right? And, you know, was this marriage going to survive? And not only did it survive, like, you know, this brought them together to become really the backbone behind the team that would go on to do the Watergate reporting and bring down Nixon. And so to tell, you know, this, you know, story of these weighty issues through this very personal lens of Kay and through this very personal lens of that relationship of Kay and Ben, right, to me that's the genius of you know, and it was all there, you know, from that remarkable spec script.
So when did they call you? When did you get a phone call?
I got a phone call sometime in March.
Yeah.
I think.
Were you in bed?
I was not.
It's
I didn't.
Your
you know exactly. No, my call came from Christy. It's you know I refer to it as it's the call from God. You know, God wants you to help out. And I was, you know, deep in prep on First Man, and it was one of these things like, you know, I don't know how I can do this. I don't know how I cannot do this. And you know, it was interesting because, you know, look, you get the call from Steven, come pitch in, we've got a very short window. You know, to give an example, Spotlight was a script that, you know, we spent the better part of 2 years working on, right? And here, you know, you have this incredible spec script, and you have 10 weeks until production, right, to get it, you
make
know,
a script into a movie.
Ship ready,
yeah.
Right? And it's one of these things where you get the call from God, and I have to say I had some trepidation, right? Because, you know, going back to the journalism well, and the thing that did for me was, you know, beyond, you know, it being excited to work with Steven and all the players involved and blah blah, and you know, clearly having a natural affinity for Christy and Amy and thinking they were dynamite producers from the get go, was I read Liz's script, and I was so taken by the story and very quickly realized, you know, Spotlight is a reporter's story. It's about reporters getting the story, right? It's not about whether to publish. It's about when to publish, right?
Mm-hmm.
You know, get the story, nail it down before you publish. This is a very different story. This is, you know, the publisher in Spotlight, you know, is in one scene, right? The you know, even Marty Baron, you know, Liev Schreiber is maybe in 20 minutes of film, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's not about those guys. It's not about down front, as the
right.
Globe guys would call it. It's about, you know, reporters, you know, Mike Resendez and Robbie Robinson, you know, great story, but it's a procedural, right? By and large. this is a character piece, and it's a character piece about a publisher wrestling with a very, very challenging decision. And if you look at, you know, the history of, you know, the Times publishes on Sunday, and, you know, on Monday, Kay's in New York because they're going to go public on Tuesday, and she's having dinner with Abe Rosenthal, all true, you know, when he gets the telex, you know, that Mitchell's going after them. Tuesday, the Post goes public, which is the same day that the injunction falls, right, on the Times. Wednesday, she's having a tiny dinner party with Robert McNamara, who, you know, who authored the study, set the study into motion at the same time as Bagdikian's getting the story. And then Thursday, she's got to make a decision whether to publish when you're in that first week of a public offering when, you know, she knows it might upend her entire business. That history is so compelling. And it's such a great decision that she has to make. And it's much more of a, you know, I make the joke, you know, Spotlight is a journalism school case. This is a business school case. This is a woman who is
a not... very compelling, thrilling, exciting, edge of your seat business.
Correct. Movie. Correct. No, but it is.
The shark didn't work.
Right. Exactly. But it's hilarious. But that's hilarious. But it's one of these scenarios where she's really, you know, got to make this decision when everyone around her, every smart business guy, every HBS business guy around her is saying, no, 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 you can't publish, right? And Kay Graham, right, who's not supposed to be in this position, understands the newspaper business better than any of them. And because of that, she is able to hear what Ben is saying, to hear what her newsroom is saying, and realize that actually the only decision for a newspaper is to publish, right? And so to push on the drama of that decision, two decisions she has to make that night, you know, and to drive towards that decision with that kind of character piece, you know, to me it was incredibly exciting. It was incredibly well laid out in the script, and not to mention it was just a little timely.
I love that you're so close to Harvard Business School. You call it HBO.
I
very intimate.
Well, I went.
Oh,
so,
there you go.
Yeah.
So, perfect sense.
And
another one of those.
No, but I hold it in. You know, it's funny. I went there and the law school, and you know, it was not my more favorite experience. And one of the things I love is that, you know, Kay Graham, you know, there's a story that the Grahams told us, because one of the great things about working with Steven is suddenly you have access to
well,
you know.
It's not. I mean, it's only access. It's like the entire world opens up and anyone you ever wanted to talk to who might have possibly had a conversation with either one of them is like, oh, yeah, I'm available, whatever you want
right,
to talk about.
Right, right. I mean, Spotlight, it took years for right. Tommy and I to, you know, work through and, you know, who are you guys? You know, and everybody knew Tom. Oh, you were, you know, in The Wire and we love Station Agent, blah, blah, blah. But, like, you know, but it still took a while yeah. to get to everyone, whereas here, you know,
Warren Buffett calls.
Right. I mean, I literally, you know, we're suddenly sitting with Don Graham, we're sitting with Lally, we're sitting with the family, we're sitting with Len Downey, who took over the paper from Ben, and you get to get into the meat of the story very quickly, yeah.
Well, I think not only that, you talk to people that knew them so that there's the voice is authentic. It's, you know, I think Len was on set with us actually for a while, and he would be like, Ben would never say that. Like, that's not a word Ben would use. And it's not, for us, that's not like, oh, that's like, great. We don't want it to right. not sound like them. We don't want it to sound like a made up. We want it to, when we want people, when they see this movie, to say, oh, that's Kay.
Mm-hmm.
Or, oh, that's Ben. I think the prickliness of Ben came across in a good way.
Yeah.
So how did the two of you team up? I mean, how, functionally, how did this relationship work?
I mean, it was very much we're shooting in 10 weeks, so all hands
yeah.
on deck.
Yeah, right.
And it wasn't, I mean, even just us. I mean, Tom and Meryl are incredibly insightful and did so much research on their own characters that it's filtering all of their notes, all of their thoughts, everything that they are kind of their feelings on any given scene or line of dialogue. And then I think, you know, at the top of the pyramid is Steven and what he is really making. I mean, I think the thing is just making the script into a movie in 10 weeks and then constantly on set.
So are you guys in a rooms together or are you?
Yeah, we're in rooms
together?
And then we're on set together.
Yeah.
We're literally on Steven's shoulder on set.
It's
I mean,
pretty unusual.
It's, I mean, yeah. I would say one of them, you know, so working with Steven is
Remarkable. I never thought of that as both as us, each on one shoulder.
No, I figure we're both on the. We were literally. No, he'd be here. And we'd be like hovering.
Yeah,
you know.
It's true though. Especially when he was on an iPad.
Yeah, yeah. Oftentimes in an iPad, taking him close to the action, we're like crouched
There's
behind
so
him.
So many
like,
photos of us like looking over.
Yeah, exactly.
Shoulder,
and to me, you know, so I come from television, right? And there, more heads are better, right? It's the greatest thing to have a room to bounce things off of as well to go back to your own. Sit down at your computer and this was it's the greatest room ever, right? I got Liz Hanna, right, who's gonna be who is the greatest writer, you know, I've met right out here, right?
Like so many checks.
Yeah, exactly. It's a good thing. So we've got Liz Hanna, we've got Steven, we've got Merrill, and working to Merrill's level is, you know, everybody's just trying to work to her level.
There's a bar that you just try and touch.
And she will find, she's like a heat-seeking missile, she will find the issue with your scene, and she will name it, right? And then you'll have to work to a level to make it better. And it's this amazing thing, because if you do, what she will give you is extraordinary. Mm-hmm. So, you know, it was very much a team effort. And the other thing which is amazing and shocking about Steven is how collaborative he is, mm-hmm. how much he wants the input. And maybe it was just because this was all happening so quickly. But, you know, how often, you know, he's asking for, you know, what do we do here? How do we, you know, we get the call coming into work. Okay, I want to do this as a Warner. You know, and so I don't want to actually be in the office with Ben and the other newspapers. I want to be with Michael Cyril Creighton, who's taking the box and, you know, stopping at the office and going around. And so can you rewrite it that way? Right. So very quickly, we're like, okay, what does he say? How does this work? What's the banter back and
Which
forth?
Tom was telling a story last night, actually, about that scene and how, you know, we had written a lot of banter that I thought was pretty good. Not in the movie in any way, and that they were like,
we're
doing this great work. It's like we're really palling around.
You're focused on a box,
and you're looking at a box.
Right.
It was like, you know, I really thought this was the bonding experience of the new. No, you didn't see it.
Right.
No.
Okay. So when you're after you get the phone call and you're sitting in the room and you're rewriting this sequence, who's typing?
Josh is typing a lot.
Yeah.
I would sometimes.
Well, you know, there's
a thing that happens at a certain point, which is like. Any number of people just become bad writers at a certain point. Like, I was like, I'm just like, I can't.
Well, yeah, so a good example of this. So there's a scene at the end of the movie. It's when Coral, she's this young woman who comes in, you know, Merrill's coming in, Kay's coming in the Supreme Court, and this young woman comes in with boxes and bumps her and then says, you know, there's another entrance to the appellants, and then, you know, says, my brother's over there, blah, blah, blah. It's a really lovely scene. You know, that Liz has written, you know, wonderful, and then she goes off and gets chewed out, right, by her boss for being late.
White male.
You know, exactly.
Again, times have changed.
And we had lines there that weren't working, and Steven's like, we need new lines, and I took a shot, and I was just, you know, it was just bad writing. And I looked at it, I was like, this is bad, and I turned to Liz. And I'm like, this is bad. She's like, let's try this. She's nice enough not to say, yeah, that sucks. She basically was like, let's try this. And we're like, blah, blah. And I was like, yep, that's it. Gave it to Steven, gave it to that, you know. So it's, again, it's literally, you know, to me, it's, you know, it's one of those wonderful things of more heads are better. And
yeah.
And again, I had expected going on, the first day we were on set, I thought, okay, well, you know, we're going to be off in Producer's Village about a mile away from Steven.
At some point,
they'll
escort us out.
And, you know, and maybe we'll get to see Steven at the end of the day and tell me he did a nice job. And instead, you know, we're pushed up to be sitting next to Steven. And I'm nervous. And I said, so you want a series? He's like, yeah, I want you right here. You know, it was really this wonderful thing. And then to watch him work, I mean, you know, it's so rare, I find, that you meet one of your heroes, somebody you've known from, you know, known tell of for years and years, and you've put them on a pedestal. Oftentimes you meet them, they come down. You know, it's how rare is it that they go up? And that was, I think, our experience with Steven. I mean, I speaking for myself, that was definitely my, you know, like, you know.
I was actually in my head just remembering him in a fireplace. That was like where I was.
Well, so it's this amazing thing. So he comes and he's got his little sketches of like these are his shots and these are the angles he wants to do and blah, blah, blah. They're on, you know, on the page. And then he'll suddenly look at the room and he'll say, "Oh, I want to think." And you know, there's a scene with Kay and Lally where
the first scene with the two of them
where they're sitting and reading the newspaper, robes. And suddenly he's literally sitting in the fireplace. You know, I've got pictures of him in the fireplace
What are you doing?
Yeah, yeah, and he's like, "Oh, this is a great two shot just from here," and then I can just get the scene, let the play like a play, like, and just get the . And there were so many moments. There was this other great moment where, it's like lunch and he's like on the floor, literally playing with a box, which is the box the Pentagon Papers are going to be in. Mm-hmm. He's just playing with the, and we come over like, "What are you doing, Steven?" And he's like, "I'm just looking at this box and I'm thinking maybe." And that's the shot where the camera comes up as the box top lifts and reveals the faces of the reporters. And we call it the Raider shot because they're all staring down. What's in the box? What's in the box? They pull out the Pentagon Papers. And it's one of these shots that, the technical of it is actually quite challenging because of the focus and what the focus puller's got to do and the way you've got to move the crane on the jib arm, move the camera on the jib arm so that it comes up perfectly and reveals the faces and then reveals Tom in the front of the shot. And it's one of these one of his magical tiny wonders where he tells the whole story of that scene in one shot, right? And that was something he just on the day is playing with the box.
That was also actually we didn't have any late days on this movie. Steven doesn't go over. I mean, it's insane. But that we were all kind of loopy that day. And that was when Sarah was doing all of her impressions for us. All of the other actors were doing this very technically difficult shot. We were getting Holly Hunter impressions from Sarah Paulson, and Carrie Coon in the back is like, "Stop having fun!" They're doing this thing, and meanwhile, and we're like, "There's no dialogue in this, Carrie. We'll see what happens." But no, it was but I think that really what that speaks to is it's light. It's people are having fun. It's Steven is the person who's having the most fun on any set he's on. And it's important for him, I think, for people to also be having fun. Mm-hmm. It's work, but you have to enjoy it. And that was really special.
It's one of these things that you could imagine being the most intimidating set in the world, right? And, we talk all the time about the first time Tracy Letts and Meryl Streep are in a scene, and Tracy says, "Can I play with this die?" And we're like, "Tracy, whatever you
want
to do, please.
If you want the computer, please feel free.
Please do a full rewrite." But, and it's incredibly nerve-wracking, yet because Steven is shockingly, just collaborative and happy to be there, and there's joy in what he's doing, and best idea wins, and it was a very light, it's a place where magic can happen.
It's very unusual to have two writers kind of in a shotgun marriage like this and have them be happy together at the end.
Paying him. I told you. I think for us it was really it was who has the ball, who picks up the ball. It was a juggling act at all times of trying to, hit that bar that Meryl has set and that they've all set. And
it sounds like in a way as your first feature that having Josh on actually was helpful.
It was great. It was,
something that usually a writer would be very,
people are like, he's like, "How did you feel?" I'm like, "Are you kidding me? I didn't have to be the only person who had to write this movie that was happening in 10 weeks for Steven Spielberg and Tom Hanks and Meryl Streep. Yeah, that was exciting for me to have somebody there who not only, has a statue on his shelf that I don't know what it is, but I've heard it. But it's somebody who is extremely talented as Josh. And I think for me also experienced on set, in production, and so being able to not just be on Steven's shoulder but on Josh's shoulder for me was a huge learning experience. And I mean, I literally think I would have had a nervous breakdown if Josh did not come on this movie, so I'm still constantly on the verge of one anyway, so it's fine.
I mean, look, I think there is, there's to me there's always the myth of the auteur, right? And look, in some cases it's true, right? But I believe, certainly, films are all about collaboration, right? It's all about the team, right? Even Steven, as great as he is, he has a team. He has Janusz and he has Rick Carter. He has Anne Roth doing incredible costumes.
Christy, who, like...
And Christy and Amy, you know, making the gears shift, and then he has this, and then it's wonderful actors. And a script, you know, in film, and maybe this is less true in...
Anne Roth?
I did. Okay, I did. Good. We all love Anne Roth.
I just like Anne Roth.
No. Exactly. Exactly. We love you, Anne. We really do. Oh, she's the best.
She's gonna watch it.
But you know the you know to me you know I think maybe more so than television you know film because you've got such incredible professionals there. It's really about collaboration. A script is not you know I mean. You know, the lines in a script, you know, are often, you know, it's the idea, it's the spirit of it, which then, you know, the actors, you know, have to make their own.
But there's a reason writers are paranoid, angry animals most of the time.
I mean,
I think because you're sitting alone by yourself.
Well, I think if you have the mentality of, no, it's you know, and to me, it's if you want your words to be exactly reproduced, you should be a playwright.
Yes.
Right, that's where your words will be exactly reproduced. You know, I don't have good enough words to you know, like that's not my game. You know, like you know, for me, it's about can we get the ideas in a good enough place such that then the actors can go play, right? And so it's and best idea wins, and more heads are better than one. And who wouldn't want to work with Liz Hannah, right? Like it really is, you know, and so. You know, it is a team effort. And so I think, like, you know, look, you know, are there going to be times where, like, it was like, go away, I got to, you know, or I'm going to be like, go away, I got to. Yeah, but it really is about, you know, trying to push ahead, you know, as a team.
And I look forward to Liz's first show on Broadway, which will be... which I'm sure will star, you know, Angela Lansbury and Ian McKellen and God knows whoever.
Well, I can't make any more movies because my bar is now too high. You've all ruined me.
Come on.
Be doing animation.
Wait until you direct. Yeah. That's going to be, that I want to see.
All animation from here on in.
I want to come back to one little story, you know, I want to come back to one little story, which I had started telling and then had lost my train of thought, which is, so in all these conversations, one of the greatest stories that was told, I thought was, you know, there was a Christmas at the Graham's house where, and I think Will told this story about, you know, everyone wondering,
who's their grandson, Katherine Graham.
Will Graham is Katherine Graham's grandson, Don's son, wonderful guy, actually a great writer in his own right, ran Mozart in the Jungle, and was a great liaison between us and the Grahams, and, you know, because he spoke our language and their language, and Will at some point told this story about they're all singing around Christmas, and, you know, what would you wish for, right, if you could wish for anything? That you know, and you know, I don't know what the other family members were wishing. Where Kay said, "I wish I had gone to HBS, right?" Which to me,
Harvard Business School,
right? Which to me, I found so amazing because it would have ruined her, right? She didn't need to go to Harvard Business School, right? This is a story of, and this is after all this when she was this great success. Like, this is a woman who understood what she was doing and you know, not only understood her business better than anyone, but understood the ethical choice and moral choice she was making. It's all my sons, right?
Yeah.
That's what this movie is. It's all my sons. It's, do I put the interests of my fellow man above my own personal interests, right? And it turns out that I'm smart enough to realize maybe my personal interests and the interests of my fellow man actually do align here, right? And so, you know, to me, there's something really wonderful, you know, not to mention, you know, maybe we should have more women in charge of our companies, our countries, it is a really wonderful story of a woman finding her voice,
I think, what that story says is so sort of inherently Kay, is this woman who was extremely successful and she still doubted herself because she didn't have a business degree. You know, is somebody who was not a victim of anything else except the times. If she had been born 20 years later, she wouldn't have had that insecurity, probably. And so I think that for us, and for me, when I was first reading her book, that was the thing I connected to, was this sort of vulnerability you feel as a woman and this self-doubt you have intrinsically just because you're a woman. And that she didn't allow herself to be victimized by it. And that she didn't allow herself to sort of crumble to the dozen men who are staring at her at the boardroom. Instead, she turned around and said, it's my company, we're going to publish.
And talk about collaboration. I mean, that's the other amazing piece is, you know, you write some semblance of words for Meryl Streep, right? And I got to say,
just string them together.
I mean, I got to say, I went back and watched Devil Wears Prada the other night. It was sort of a real guilty pleasure. And she's so good. And what's amazing to me is like, so think about that woman and think about this woman. And one, you know, talk about performance in terms of how is it possible that Meryl Streep can be so convincing as that woman and so convincing as this woman, who clearly were just of totally different DNA, right? And also just two very different and yet really powerful examples of female leadership in this incredible way. You know, it's one of those things. You just toss up the ball to Meryl, and you know, and as good as you know she is, it's that much more breathtaking to see what she does with the work.
Somebody asked me what the most surprising thing about watching the movie was for the first time, and I was like, well, the dumbest answer you're going to get is Meryl Streep, because we knew how good she was. We saw her on set. She's also Meryl Streep, and then you watch her performance in this, and you're like, oh my God, Meryl Streep! It's a bizarre revelation to have about Meryl. But
the thing that's remarkable is on set you're watching, and oftentimes, you know, a good actor, they won't do what was in your head. They'll do like the second reading or the third reading. Meryl oftentimes it is the fourth or the fifth, to the extent that sometimes like she's laughing and we're looking at each other.
Why are you
like,
laughing?
Why is she laughing in that moment? That feels odd. That doesn't really. And you find yourself questioning this weird way, and then you watch the movie and you understand she has made this arc so perfectly. She understood that arc better than you did, right? She understood the dramatic arc of her character in a way that, like, you know, no other actor I've ever worked with has been able to pull that together in such a powerful way. And you know, I mean, when the first time I screened the movie, I just started yelling, fuck Meryl, oh my God. I literally started, and Steven turns to me, he's like, well, you thought Tom was good too? I'm like, yeah, Tom's great, but I knew Tom was great. Look, that is insane. I literally lost my marbles.
Then a wildfire story. So when I watched it, I was sitting next to Amy for the first time, and after the decision, and Meryl likes it, which for me is like the moment that her performance kind of sings, Amy grabbed me and was like, isn't she great? And she scared the shit out of me so much. I was like, Amy! and I was like, she was like, isn't she amazing? And I was like, uh-huh. I'm just going to like come get my heart rate back down.
And
she just, I mean, everyone is stunned by the performance. So,
It's a good, I think that's the best feeling a screenwriter can have, is to see somebody take the work somewhere you never thought it could go.
Oh, it's
amazing. Well, it makes us look great, so.
Thank you guys so much for your time.
Thank you.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
And next time we'll just talk about Tom Hanks the whole time.
See, yeah, seriously.
Really, I know, we have to start actually, like, really doing the Tom dance.
That's true. Time.